Okay, so today most of the class will be on implementation of graphs. So last time we talked about the various ways to model vertices and edges in a graph, the different kind of problems that we have in graphs. And we actually went over the basic implementation of a graph. Today I will just remind you this implementation so we can basically continue with different traversals of graphs. Depth first search, breadth first search, and then two implementations, one of how to visualize a graph, and the second one is how to solve a problem, how to take a problem that doesn't directly have any graph notion, but then implement it using a graph, and then implement the shortest path in the graph using breadth first search. So just to remind you that there were different ways to store the edges of a graph, and we basically are going to use in this class adjacency edge list. So in fact, what we are going to have is an array of all of the vertices in a list, and then we are going to use the indices in that array as the indices of vertices that are basically used for creating edges. And then how do we actually store the edges? We store them in adjacency edge list. So basically every original vertex will have a list of all of the edges. So basically we have one level in which we basically have an array, a list, which is basically a list. But here is an example of an array, but we can represent this as an array list. As an array list of a reference for every single one of the vertices. And that reference is a reference to a list of edges. And those edges are basically defined using the indices in the vertices table, which is just an array of the vertices. And this is actually the implementation that we are going to use. We are going to use a list of an array list of edges. So basically the edge corresponding to the edges corresponding to the first element, to the first vertex is a new array list. And then we are adding in that element in neighbors at index zero, every one of the edges. Basically there is an edge from 0 to 1, from 0 to 3, and 0 to 5. And then we add another array list as the next element in this list neighbors. Okay. So this is how we are going to model graphs. And also last time we defined an interface graph, and this graph enumerated all of the methods that are available to graphs. Get the size of the graph, get the list of those edges, get the list of vertices and so on. But this is just, these are all abstract methods. This is an interface. Then we implement partially this interface in the abstract graph class. And we are also going to use this one to implement the different methods of traversal, breadth first search, and depth first search. And then we implement today unweighted graphs, simple graphs that don't have a weight for the edges. So this was the interface that we went over last time. The interface graph that basically has all of these methods, get size, get vertices, get the vertex actually at a given index, get the index of a certain vertex, get the neighbors of a vertex, get the degree of a vertex, print the edges for the entire graph, and so on. And then we also went over the implementation of this interface and the implementation of the abstract graph class. So an abstract graph is basically a direct implementation of a graph. We have a list for the vertices and a list of edges for the adjacency list for the neighbors. So the first element will basically be the list of all the edges that start from that first vertex. And the next element is the list of all the edges that start from the second vertex and so on. We have standard methods for constructors, construct an empty graph, construct a graph that iterates over a list of vertices, or an array of vertices and the edges, and it basically calls the method add vertex and create adjacency list. Really what we want to see is the inner class edge. So an edge is basically a simple class that has two dynamic fields, U and V, and they basically define a vertex, an edge. And one thing that I want to add is that if you want to implement a weighted graph, the only thing that you may have to change is the edge class to also include a double weight of that edge. So we have the two vertices, we need the weight of the edge. The rest of the methods, we actually covered them last class. So basically when you want to add a new edge, that edge has a U, which is the origin. If there is already an element in the array neighbors for that specific edge, we basically get that array and we add the edge to that array. And this blue line is actually the command to create this adjacency list of edges. The rest are just so error control. You basically check that the indices are between the indices that you are expecting for the two vertices. The rest of the methods, we kind of covered them last class. So we have other constructors for different inputs, overloaded constructors for the different types of inputs. We have the create adjacency list, which basically iterates over all of the edges and adds each edge to the adjacency list that method that we had before. We have the methods for adding a single edge, getting the size, getting the vertices, getting the vertex at an index is just a method that from that list, we get the element at that index. And the opposite, if you are passing the vertex, the index of in that list of that vertex will give you the index in that of that vertex. So quite straightforward methods if you have the array, the list of vertices implemented. Then we have the get neighbors. If you pass an index, all that you basically have to return is a new array list. And for every one of the reason why I'm creating a new array list is that I don't want to return a shallow pointer to the old array list that were the neighbors of a certain node of a certain vertex. So in this case, I basically iterate over neighbors.get of that index. And for every edge, I add the destination of that edge to the result, that array list of vertices that are neighbors to the current node. And then finally, we have the get degree, which returns just the size of the array list that is the adjacency list of edges for the current node V. We can also clear the entire graph by clearing the vertices and the neighbors. Printing the edges basically iterates over all of the vertices, or which is basically the same with iterating over the list of neighbors. And then for every neighbors, which is basically every vertex, we iterate over actually those neighboring edges. And we print out that for that specific vertex, like Seattle, these are the neighbors, these are the destinations of the edges starting from Seattle. So I basically print the origin and the destination. Adding a vertex checks if the vertices don't already contain that additional vertex, and if they don't, then I basically add it as the last element. And I'm also adding a new array list as the last element of neighbors. So currently it basically says there are no outgoing edges from this node. Now, a new class, unweighted graph, extends abstract graph with basically a graph that is unweighted. And all of the methods that you see here are just calling the superclass constructor with the edges and the number of vertices. So basically they are using the constructors from the superclass. a simple example that basically does create multiple graphs, and we talked again about it last class, was this one in which I created an array of strings for the vertices, an array of edges, and I constructed a new graph, unweighted graph, for those vertices and those edges. And similarly, I basically create a new graph for names, Peter, Jane, Mark, Cindy, and Wendy. And again, I create a list of an adjacency list for the for basically the edges. And I basically pass it as, this is just an array, a list of edges, and I pass it to the constructor to create that. We cover all this in the last class. Basically, it's an example of creating two graphs. Today's lecture is really about graph traversals. And what is a graph traversal is the process of visiting each vertex in the graph exactly once. And as we had in the case of trees, it can be done in different ways. One is the depth first search or depth first traversal, which basically starts from the from one node, and it starts visiting one neighbor, one destination from that node of an edge. And then from that node, it continues searching for another node that is a neighbor of that second node, and then another neighbor of the third node, and so on. And only when it basically reaches a leaf or a node that now doesn't go to any other node that has not been visited already, it backtracks. So that's the depth first search. A breadth first search starts level by level. So you start from a node, then you visit all its neighbors, then you put in a queue all of the neighbors of those neighbors, and you start visiting them in order. While you are visiting new nodes, you put them back into the same queue. So after I finish with the current neighbors, I will continue with the next level. Now, both traversals result in a spanning tree. So we talked about spanning tree earlier, which is basically a subgraph that is a tree, and you basically started from a root, and you basically have the neighbors as part of a tree. So a spanning tree, if you remember, is basically a subgraph of the original graph, such that you have a root and the all the vertices are in a tree. So from that root, you get first level would be the first neighbors, then the second level would be the their own neighbors, and so on. So both traversals, depth first search and breadth first search, are basically a tree. Now, how is that tree represented? First, we need an integer for the root. It's the index of the vertex that is the root. Then we have an array parents of integers, which has the same length with the number of vertices. So basically, the values in the indices in this array correspond to what is the parent of the vertex at the given index of in this indexed variable in the array. So for instance, parent of zero would be who is the parent of the node of the vertex at index zero in the array of vertices that we have in the graph. And similarly, parent of one will be the parent of the vertex that has the index one. Parent of two is the parent of, it's an integer that is the index of the parent of the node with the index two, and so on. So basically, because we know that to every node in a tree, you have a single parent, you can store basically the tree in an array of the same number of integers as you have in the array of vertices. And the root will have the index minus one, basically it doesn't have a parent. Now, it's not always guaranteed that we are getting a tree where you have a single root. The problem is that it may be that you have strongly connected components, different parts of the graph which are not connected with other parts of the graph. So still they can be represented with this notation, with this tree, because you will have multiple elements whose parent is minus one. That means that they are a root of a tree, but they don't have a parent in the rest of the graph. The search order is basically just a list of integers in which we keep the order in which we encounter the elements, starting from the root. We basically, for every element, we put it, once we visit it, we put it in the search order. So next time we find it on another branch, we basically reject it out. We say that we already visited this node. This is also very useful for implementing basically an algorithm to find cycles in our graph. Because if you encounter a node that is already in the search order, that basically means already that, oh, I found a cycle. Okay. So we have multiple methods that will be implemented in this tree implementation. Tree that takes the root, the parent array of integers, and the search order, and returns such and creates such a tree. Get root, which returns that index of the root, just this int. Get search order, which returns that search order. Get parent of a node int I, which basically just returns parent of I of that integer. Get number of vertices found. So if you start from one node and you build a tree, then you basically, the number of nodes that you reached is the number of vertices found. If there are other vertices whose values is minus one, that's basically those that are not in and that are not in the current strongly connected component. Get path, which given an integer, it returns the path from that integer to the root, like we did in binary search trees. Print path does exactly the same, prints the path from the root to the specified vertex, and print tree prints the entire tree with root and then all the edges. So depth first search. These methods are quite easy to implement. Basically, depth first search starts from a vertex. So the input is a graph and the started vertex, let's call it lowercase v. And the output is one of these trees rooted at v. And the implementation uses recursion. So first you mark that node that it has been visited, v. Then for every neighbor of w of v, if w hasn't been visited yet, then you said that v is the parent of w, and you call depth first search for w. So you see that basically now you will continue in doing the depth first search from the child, although you haven't finished all the neighbors of the original node v. Since each edge and each vertex is visited only once, the time complexity of depth first search is basically the sum of the number of edges plus the number of vertices. So it's linear in the number of vertices plus the number of edges. So now here is an example. Let's say that we start from zero. And what this algorithm basically does, visit zero, then it starts with the neighbors w of zero. So it finds the first neighbor is one. Now, it sets that one has as the parent, one's parent is zero, and then it calls depth first search, so the same method, on one. So in the next step, basically it tries to find paths from one. So it will add to the path, the search list, the path from one to two. So now the algorithm for depth first search continues. Basically, we are now for the neighbors of two, and it basically looks at all the neighbors of two, and it looks at zero. And of course that we have already seen, it looks at one, then it looks at three, and three is a new neighbor. So it continues the path. Now from three, we cannot get from other nodes that haven't been visited yet. We can only get to zero and two, and those have been visited. So it basically finishes that for loop and it returns in the previous step. So now it will look at two, but for two, we also have other nodes that we haven't visited. So again, it finishes this for loop and returns to the previous step when we were at one. And then in the for loop, it just goes to the next neighbor of one, which is four. And it basically also adds it to the list of search nodes, and it sets as a parent of 4, 1. This is how depth search works. Basically, we keep this arrays of parents and the nodes that were already visited. And with this recursive method, we prefer always to go to the next node than actually going back to the neighbors of the current node. Breadth first search is very much the same, only that instead of going through recursion, it adds the W to a queue. So it basically continues looking for other nodes in the same queue. So it processes first all of the children of the root before it goes to the next level, children of the root. Any questions about depth first search before we get into how to implement it? Okay. So here is an example. For instance, I want to do depth first search from Chicago. And it starts, in this case, basically, I look for basically one edge. And again, it's non-deterministic. So in some nodes, even in the root like Chicago, I can choose to go to another node instead of going to Seattle. But once I'm going to Seattle, I'm looking for other nodes from Seattle. So it goes to, it chooses San Francisco, from San Francisco to Los Angeles, from Los Angeles to Denver, from Denver, all the options that I have seen before, except going to Kansas. Again, from Kansas, I already seen Chicago, Denver, and Los Angeles. So it goes to New York. From New York, it goes to Boston. And since Boston is only connected to Chicago and New York, I can't continue with depth first search. So it backtracks to New York, and then it goes to Atlanta, a new town in our scene list. From Atlanta, it can go either to Dallas or to Houston. I chose to go to Miami. And from Miami, I go to Houston because Atlanta I've already seen. And again, from Houston, because Miami and Atlanta I've already seen, I'm going back to Dallas. Of course, what happens next, it will backtrack all the way back to the root, but there is nothing else to visit. So this is basically the spanning tree returned for this depth first search. Again, it's non-deterministic. It's deterministic based on the algorithm that you're writing, but there are other spanning trees obtained by depth first search. So this is the implementation. So first we have this inner class in the abstract graph class, which contains the root as an integer, the parent, and the search order as a list of integers. So the most important here is this parent array of integers, because for every index, it stores the parent vertex of that index. Due to basically depth first search or depth first traversal. So here we have a bunch of, I have a constructor, I have the get root, an accessor. Here I have a method that given a parent a vertex V, parent of V basically returns what's the index of the parent of that vertex V. Get search order returns the search order, which is just a list of integers. And get number of vertices found returns the search order size, basically the current number of vertices that were found with that first search. Get path returns an integer for given an integer index. It basically returns, it creates an array path, array list path for the path from that index to the root, and starts adding the vertices at that index. Then the index becomes the parent of that node, the parent of that index, and it continues in the do while loop. While the index is different than minus one, basically until it reaches the root and it goes with the index to the parent of the root. So it's really just a method to return the path. Okay, from a node to the root. Print path does exactly the same, but instead of returning it, it prints it. Print tree prints the root and then all of the edges. Basically, we iterate over all of the indices of the nodes, and for every node, for every vertex, it prints the parent of that vertex, which is basically all that we need to build a tree. So the most important method is depth-first search. So depth-first search is an abstract graph, and it implements that pseudocode that we saw before. So it basically creates the search order as an array list. It creates the parent integer array as an integer array of the same size with vertices. So basically now we know that the element, the parent of the vertex at that index is basically in this array, is the value corresponding to that index variable. For every integer I in from zero to the length of the array, it says the parent of that node I to be minus one. Basically, it initializes the entire array to minus one. I'm also creating an array of visited. I could have used the list of search order, but this is much faster. I create an array again of the same size with vertices, and then I call recursively a depth first search starting from V. The parent is this array that will be created for the tree. The search order is basically the order in which we visited the nodes. And is visited is this Boolean array that tells me if a node have been seen or not, and is the same size with the vertices. So the same indices apply to is visited. And finally, the moment that I find the depth first search, I return a new tree with the parent, the root, the parent, and the search order. So the real depth first search method is the helper method below. It takes an integer for the vertex, an array of parents, which are all minus one, a list of integers for the search order, and a Boolean array visited. And this is basically the implementation. It first adds to the search order the node U, the node that we start with. It also initializes for the array index variable is visited for you with true. We have seen the root. And then for every edge in the neighbors of you, so basically it starts with the first neighbor. If that neighbor is visited of the destination of that edge, which is V, hasn't been visited, then the parent of V becomes U, the previous node that we have just seen. And then we call depth first search from V, the same array parent, the search order, and is visited. So what basically this does is depth first search. It for a node, it starts with the first node and it calls depth first search on it, the first child. Then for it, it calls the first search on its first child and so on. And here I have an example. Basically, it's the same example that I had before, but I call that first search for this array starting from Chicago. And I can show you. So depth first search in the code that I sent you today basically returns the depth first search from the node Chicago. So the parent of Seattle is Chicago. So we start from the root is Chicago, then Chicago goes to Seattle. From Seattle, we go to San Francisco. From San Francisco, we go to Los Angeles in the spanning tree. From Los Angeles, we go to Denver. From Denver, we basically don't go anywhere. No, we do go to Kansas City. From Kansas City, we go to New York. From New York, we go to Boston. There, we cannot find any other node, so we backtrack. And from New York, we go to Atlanta. From Atlanta, we go to Miami. From Miami, we go to Houston. And from Houston, we go to Dallas. So this is the spanning tree, but it's basically just printing that array. for parent. Okay. So basically this is what I did here. And for that tree, that is the spanning tree, you can extract a lot of information. You can get the number of vertices found. In this case, this is, it doesn't have strongly connected components. Basically the entire graph is a strongly related component. We can iterate over the search order, which is how, in what order we did we find those nodes, those vertices. And we can print that search order. So that's Chicago, Seattle, San Francisco, Los Angeles, Denver, Kansas City, and so on. Or we can go over the search order, and then if the parent of that node is different than minus one, we specify who's the parent of every node. There are many applications of that first search. One is detecting if the graph is connected. So you start from a vertex, you do that first search all the way. And then if the number of vertices that you found with that first search is the same with the number of vertices in the original graph, then the graph is connected, meaning that all from every node, we can find a path to every other node. If it's not, then you also have in this array of parents, all of the nodes that are not connected with to the subgraph that starts from the root. You can also detect whether there is a path between two vertices, and you can also find it. Not the shortest, but you can find the path. So you do that first search, and then you can just ask for the path if the parent of that of the node is not minus one. Basically, you can find the path, and in many cases, you may actually have to go from that node to the root. Or you can do the depth first search from the root, from one of the nodes that you want to in that path. Okay. It doesn't guarantee the shortest path because basically we go depth first search. It may be the case, like in our example that we have seen before, that basically I could have gotten faster from Chicago to Kansas, but I basically in depth first search, I went all of the way through Seattle, San Francisco, Los Angeles, and Denver. So it's not the shortest path. Another application of depth first search is finding all the connected components. So a connected component is the maximum connected subgraph in which every pair of vertices are connected by a path. So for instance, if you have a graph, let's say that it has many nodes, and we have some edges, say from this node to this node, oops. From this one to this one, maybe from this, we have an edge here. So one strongly connected component is basically these nodes. From every node, you can find a path to other nodes. But this one, other one is not connected at all with basically the other one above. So this is another strongly connected component. This isolated node here is a strongly connected component. So basically a strongly connected component are all of the nodes that are connected. So in this case, this wouldn't have been a strongly connected component because the definition says the maximum connected subgraph in which every pair of vertices are connected by a path. Okay. You can also find, but a little bit more difficult, if there is a cycle. So you basically do that for search as we have seen it before. The only difference is that the moment that you see that basically a node has been visited before, you declare that there is a cycle, because now you know that from the current node we can get to the root, and from the root you can get back to the current node on another branch. So you basically can only find, you can find the path from the current node E to the destination of E, basically the origin of EU to the root, and then you can ask for the path from the node V to the root, and then you have a cycle, because from V you can get to the root, from the root you can get to U, and from U you can get back to E, to V. So it's also useful to find a cycle. Before I continue with breadth-first search, any questions? Breadth-first search visits the graph level by level. So it starts by adding the root to a queue, and then at each level it removes the element from the queue, one element from the queue, and then it adds all of the children to the queue. And then takes the first child, adds the grandchildren to the queue, and continues with the next child and so on. So in order to ensure that every vertex is only visited once, it skips all the vertices that have been already seen. Okay. So here is the algorithm. Breadth-first search takes a vertex and the graph. It creates an empty queue for the basically the storing the vertices that have to be visited. And it adds the root V to the queue. It marks V as visited. While this queue is not empty, it dequeues the top element, which or the last element, the first element that was first in, first out. And then it processes U, which really means it marks U as visited. Then for every neighbor, V or U, if V hasn't been visited, then it adds W, sorry, to the queue. And then it continues. It says the parent for W as being V, and it marks W as visited. So the difference between breadth-first search and depth-first search, in depth-first search, we use recursion. In breadth-first search, we use a queue. So from one node, we basically can't get the children of that node or the neighbors of that node. And then we choose one of the neighbors and we get to all of the neighbors of that node and so on. So this is basically this example. We start from zero, and it queues 1, 2, and 3. Then it dequeues 1, and it queues 4. And then it basically dequeues 2, 3, and then 4. And we found the spanning tree, the blue one in this example. So for that previous example with countries, with cities, you basically just take all of the neighbors of Chicago, then starting from the left-hand side, you take the neighbors of Seattle. Denver is not chosen because it has already been seen from the root. Then it takes the neighbors of Denver, then the neighbors of Kansas City. Then once it's done with grandchildren, it goes to great-grandchildren. It takes the neighbors of Atlanta, which are Houston and Miami. So basically, the implementation is kind of similar. We start with a list, which is the search order and the list of the parents. Then we iterate over the parents to set them all to -1. We create a queue for basically the queue to implement the breadth-first search. And we offer the root V to the queue. And then we define an array is visited of booleans of the same size with the vertices. By default is all false. And then we set the root as being true. We mark it as visited. While the queue is not empty, we pull an element out of the queue. We add it to the search order. And then for the neighbors of that element U, it adds, if it, the neighbor hasn't been visited, it adds it to the queue. And this continues. Basically, for all the neighbors, it adds them to a queue. But the next element that is pulled from the queue is actually the sibling, basically the multiple children of the root. Okay. So again, I wrote a test and I called breadth-first search, and it basically builds that second tree, that you spanning tree that you have seen before. So these are the two methods for breadth-first search for that graph. And depth-first search. Okay. Any questions? There are many applications of breadth first search, even more interesting for depth first search than for depth first search. Again, you can check if the graph is connected, if basically there is a path between any two vertices in the graph, and that's what connected means. But how to write, how to do it, you basically just check if the size of the spanning tree is the same with the number of vertices. Okay. Detecting if there is a path between two vertices, you start a breadth first search from a vertex, and then at some level you will get to the other vertex. And actually that path that you are finding, the path from that node to the root, is the shortest path. So you start between one of them that you declare the root and a breadth first search. And in the spanning tree, the shortest path between the second node and the root is the shortest path, because in breadth first search, you consider the neighbors first, then the grandchildren, and then the great grandchildren, and so on. So basically you have the shortest path will be reached first and added to the breadth first search spanning tree. Again, you can find all of the connected components. A connected component is this maximum subgraph in which every pair is connected by a path. Basically, how can you do it? You start from a vertex and you get a spanning tree. All of the vertices included in the spanning tree are strongly connected. There is a path between any two vertices in this subset. Okay. Finally, you can detect if there is a cycle. So a cycle basically is a path from a node to itself by not repeating the same edge in a undirected graph. So again, you can modify the breadth first search method. If the node have been seen before, you know that there is a cycle, because you can get from the current node to that node, and then you can find the path from that node to the root, and you can find the path from the current node to the root. And that gives you a cycle. You can also extract that cycle, because you get the path from the node, basically, that you found that there is a cycle, and you can go to the root, and then from the other node that goes to the current node, you would go to the root, and that's a cycle in the graph. Also, you can test if a graph is bipartite. So bipartite is actually a special instance of something in algorithms in graph theory that is called n-colorable. That means that you can color with a certain number of colors the graph, and no two neighboring vertices have the same color. So a bipartite graph is a graph that is two-colorable. That means that I can color it such that I cannot find an edge where the two vertices on that edge have different color. So, and how can I do it? Basically, the moment that as you are basically finding breadth first search, you color with one color the root. Then its children, you color them with the other color. Then their children, we color them with the other color, and this continues. If you find a child that have been seen before and its color is different than the current node that we want to basically the neighbor that we are currently in, then it's okay. But if it's the same color, then it means that it's not a bipartite graph, that I cannot divide the set of vertices into odd stratas and even stratas, basically into subsets that there are no connections between them. So here is an example of graph visualization. So basically, this is with JavaFX. I'm creating an interface displayable, which is basically just a bunch of methods for getting the x and y coordinate for the node that is displayable. Then I'm creating a graph view, which is a JavaFX pane. And in this graph view, basically we'll keep the nodes, the vertices, and their position, and also a line between the vertices. So initially, graph extends this displayable, and basically has a constructor that creates the graph and draws the vertices. And the vertices are basically just edge lines, circles, and text between at the points that are defined for these vertices. So I get the X and Y coordinate for every vertex. Then I get the name and I put a circle at that coordinate X, Y with a radius of 16. Then I'm adding the text into that position at X minus 8 and Y minus 8. So basically below a little bit of and to the left of that position. Then I iterate over the graph. I draw all the edge pairs over for pairs of vertices. So neighbors are the neighbors of an index I, of a vertex I. I get the X and Y coordinate of that vertex. And for every neighbor V in the neighbors, the position X2, Y2 of that vertex is got from the data. And then I draw an edge, a new line between X1, Y1, the parent, and X2, Y2, the child. Finally, display US map extends application. So it's just an example of a JavaFX application that is a graph. As you can see, basically I create a graph first. I create an array of cities with their positions. I create an integer adjacency matrix. And then I create the graph, which is an unweighted graph for those vertices and edges. And I'm adding the graph view, which is basically that graph that I've seen before, but put in a pane in JavaFX to the current scene. And I'm setting that scene to be in the primary stage. City implements displayable, only that it also adds the name field of that city. And here is basically the rest, which is just you get the X and Y coordinates and the name for every city, and you call the launch method for this JavaFX app. So most of it is really implemented as the graph itself. The rest is just displaying this graph in the UI. Another problem, so this is a problem that at the first view has nothing to do with graphs. It's called the nine-tail problem. It's a puzzle. Nine coins are placed 3x3 in a matrix. Some are face up, that means that the head is up, and some are face down, the tail is up. So basically, a legal move is the following game, that you can reverse any coin that has the face up H. But you also have to reverse all its neighbors. So for instance, if I basically choose, let's say H to be the node that I basically will flip, then its neighbors, which are all H in this example, will also flip to tails. Similarly in this position. So if this is the input and I flip H, I will basically get T instead of it. Instead of the H to the left, I get T. Instead of the T above, I get H. And instead of the H to the right lower corner, I get tail. So basically from one configuration, you can basically find paths to other configurations. And the problem is to find the shortest path, the shortest number of moves, such that you can get to the last configuration here. Basically that all of the coins are with the tail up, okay? So how do we represent it as a graph? Basically, the moment that this problem was defined, you can already see that actually there are multiple states all of the possible states, all of the tails are up, or all tails except the lower corner is up, or all coins are up except the lower middle coin, and so on. So in total, you can see that every position can flip 0 to 1. So for 0, the first corner 0, you have all of the other options. For 1, you have all of the other options, and so on. So basically, there are 2 to the power 9, two possibilities for the first cell, two possibilities for the second cell, and so on. So in total, there are 512 nodes. And you can label them with the decimal value that binary value is. So you basically can represent the array as an array, the matrix as an array of characters. Basically, you have the first row, the second row, and the third row. So, and then really you convert that if it's in binary, like 0 and 1, 0, 0, 0 is basically for heads, and 1, 1, 1 are for tail. And you convert it from binary. So in this case would be 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0 into decimal. Now the end state, the one in which you basically have all tails, is really the last number that can be converted into 9 digits, which is 511. And this basically means that all the faces are down. You can construct a graph. And this graph is basically, you can start a Bradford search from the end position, 511. And you can basically see if you flip any coin in that matrix, what would basically result in. So if, for instance, if I flip the lower middle 1 into 0, I basically would get, this one. I get 0 in the lower corner, lower middle, with zeros around it, not on the diagonal, only on the vertical and horizontal. And from that one, you can basically also start flipping and see where you get. So for instance, I can flip in that position the middle. Actually, I can flip the upper one to 0, and I get its neighbors flip to 0 and the middle element to 1. So basically, I can build a graph because through many paths, I can get to the same positions. The question is, what's the minimum number of moves that I have to do to reach the final case? So after I build the Bradford search, I just get the path from basically any node that I'm interested in, into which I can get. So this is how we implement it. Basically, we will get a spanning tree rooted at the node 511, which is the end node. And that's really just a spanning tree. And then I have the implementation of 9 tails. So I have an abstract graph that will basically represent the entire graph. And basically this, the constructor takes first, gets the edges. I'm creating an unweighted graph with the edges and the number of nodes. And I call the Bradford search from 511. The get edges method basically first defines the adjacency list of edges, which is basically stores the edges. And then I iterate from 0 to the number of nodes for every, which is basically the 2 to the power, it's actually 512, 2 to the power 9. Then for every one, I iterate from 0 to 9. So for every one of those nodes, I basically flip one position. I get the character array for that node, basically the node for the vertex U. I check if that node is heads, only then I can flip it. And if it is, I basically get the flip node after I change the neighbors, and I'm adding the new abstract graph edge to the set of edges. Basically, I'm creating this edge this graph, which are basically transitions between positions. Then I have a method for flipping. So if I flip a position, I basically have to flip all of the possible neighbors, if those neighbors exist. Flipping a cell, again, within the boundary, if depending on the position of that cell, if it's a head, then that position becomes a tail. And similarly, if it's not a head, then it was a tail, so it becomes head. And then I basically have methods to transform from index to node and from node to index. So indexes are indices in this array. And really, if you give me an index as a decimal number and the node is tail, then the result is incremented with multiplied with 2 and added 1. So I basically transform from binary, the binary representation of that node, into the actual integer number that corresponds to that node. And vice versa, if you pass me the integer, I basically create a matrix for the result, and I do a conversion from decimal to binary to get actually the matrix with H and T for the head and tails. So finally, the ninetail method is just to use this graph. So I'm asking the user to enter a new 9-coin collection for the rows for the original position. And then basically I get a model, which is basically a graph for that previous example, for that implementation of the ninetail model. And I'm getting the shortest path in that model, starting from the index that is the initial node. So it basically finds all the paths from the end node 511 to every other node. And then for that node that I want to find the shortest path, I do breadth first search and I get the shortest path. So I have an example that I want to show you. So this is the ninetail problem. And let's say that I'm passing head, tail. You can see it as a matrix, really. And for this specific input, I basically get that, first of all, I can flip the middle position, and then you see that this becomes basically actually if I flip the middle position, it should have also flipped the all of the coins adjacent to it. So this here should have become a tail. And it didn't. Okay, so we have an error in the program. Basically, I didn't flip all of the positions. If I flip the middle, it flips this entire row from tails to heads, and also the middle position here, but it didn't flip the top position, and that's still H. So the algorithm didn't quite work. Wasn't the mention that you can only flip two adjacents in one step though? Let's see. So a legal move is to take any coin that is with head up and reverse together with all of the coins adjacent to it. So basically, this doesn't include coins that are on the diagonal. But in our case, so for instance, for this example, if you flip H, it flips this, and this. And you can see that it did flip them. For this position, it flips basically all of these to tails. And that's how I got to that position. But in my example, basically, what could I have flipped? So that it basically, what could have the algorithm flipped that I get this matrix after the flip? And the only thing that I could think of is that I flip the middle, and then you can basically see that this become heads. I have to flip a head. So what head did I flip to get to that part? Because there is no head that flipped. So something in the algorithm is wrong in flipping, because the path that I'm getting here is definitely not correct. But let me see if there are other issues with this path. So from this, how did I get to this? Basically, if I flipped H here, it does flip H into T, this middle H into T, and this T into an H. So this is correct. I do get this step. Next step, how do I get from this to this? So I can see that the bottom H is flipped, and then it basically flips this T and this H into H and T. And then finally, in the last step, previous to last step, sorry, one of the steps, it flips this position, and then it becomes T, H, and T. So this is also fine. Then in this position, I see that it flips the last element, the previous to last, and of course also this one. So it basically flips this H into a T, and it gets to this position. And here it's clear that you basically flip the middle, and then it gets to all tails. So the only step that I'm not getting is how do I get from this to this? Because basically, if I do flip the middle, then this one should have become a tail. So let me see one more time this example. Everything else is fine. So there is only one flip that I do not get, which is if you flip the middle in this case, the middle will become an H, this becomes a T, this becomes an H, this becomes an H, and this becomes an H. So it is almost the same with this. The only difference is that this is not correct. So I have one flip that is not actually working, and it continues. So that is continues in the same way. And in fact, you can see that in the last case, I flip the head and it changes all of them. So there is one step that I do not get what exactly happened, which is this first step in our algorithm. So I will look over this example again and try to figure it out. Why don't we actually get the correct flips? Okay, the answer is I do not know. Basically, I will have to debug this program, and I will do it after I stop the recording. Okay, any questions? If not, that's all about graphs. Go ahead. Did you figure it out?
No, I didn't figure this one out. Just like questions moving forward. No, never mind. Sorry, I figured out my problem.
Okay, not a problem. Okay, good. So let's do the lab and then we'll basically continue with I will try to debug this problem and figure it why it doesn't it quite work. Okay, thank you very much.